Welcome to Community Connections with Children's Services Council of St. Lucie County. I'm one of your hosts, Sean Boyle, and with me is
Ashley Ma.
And welcome to the half-hour radio program that once a month becomes a monthly television show on WLX-TV to talk about what resources and or ways for you to get involved with children and families in our community we call St. Lucie County. Now, we at the Children's Services Council are not professional hosts.
What?
But once a week and once a month, we play them so that we can talk about ways to get involved. But at the Children's Services Council, we do five things for our community. And those five things are: one, make sure every baby's a healthy baby. Two, stop child abuse before it happens. Three, keep kids off the streets. Four, keep them in school. And five, keep them off drugs, alcohol, and other risky behaviors by offering programs and resources for all families in our community.
Good job.
I said the word community,
you
correct?
You did so many times, actually.
I'm on a roll.
You did good. So Sean talked about those priority areas, but there's a couple different ways where you can learn more about those programs. One of them, obviously, is on this show, either our weekly radio show or our monthly TV show. But we also have a great website. It's actually a new website. So on that website, at cscslc.org, you can get a list of all of the programs that we work with in the community, success stories from each of those programs, which we love to share. We've been updating as well. And we also share information from time to time, either resources for parents, tips on any number of things. We've shared some water safety tips recently. We've shared some tips on how to read with your kids recently. So there's a lot of really good information on our website. One of the other things that we have updated in addition to our website is our family guide. So we talk about this out in the community quite a bit, and this is a new look for the family guide as well.
It's a thinner version. It's a New Year's resolution to get thinner, yeah. And our program guide did so.
It is getting smaller and smaller, which is, you know, ironic because we're getting more and more programs in there. So this is the new version of our family guide, which you can get in this printed format. It is also available on our website. But we have copies of this family guide that we can bring to your church, to your business. We've given a ton out to the schools recently. They ask for them quite a bit. So we have tons of these. We'd love to distribute them to you or your business. Just give us a call at the office and we'll make sure that you get some.
We also have a new logo, a new look.
We do have a new logo, which is featured on our new website and on this new family guide. So we did post a message about it on our Facebook about a week or so ago, but we're going to slowly start to make those changes. So it's not going to be like one fell swoop. You'll see everything new at once. But we're trying to be conscious of the things that we change as we go. So we're using some of the materials that we have with the old logo, and then we'll start transitioning to the new.
And because it is March, that means summer is just around the corner.
Oh, I thought you were going to say it meant my birthday was just around the corner.
Oh, it is your birthday season.
It is my birthday
season. Because it is in March. Correct. It is your birthday season. Just as important as Ashley's birthday season is, summer will be upon us very soon. So if you have kids or grandkids and you're not sure what you're going to do with them in the summer, now is the time to begin thinking about how to enroll them and where you want to enroll them in summer camp so that they have something positive and active to do during the summer months. So we at the Children's Services Council, as we've talked about before, we fund after-school programs, and they are like transformers. They turn into summer programs, but in addition to that, we provide an additional, I believe, 12 to 13 additional summer offerings that will be available on our website in the upcoming months. So stay tuned, but don't forget that summer is just around the corner.
It's scary to think about that.
I know summer's just around the corner?
It's hot.
It's very hot.
I feel like it's been hot for a while.
Now, we haven't explain this in a while, but because we have a guest that we're going to introduce very shortly, I kind of want to just go over the history of how this program started, mostly for her benefit, but also for the audience benefit. So we know this was at least 6 years ago.
Right, because we have someone who was recently a guest who had a child in that time.
Right, in that time, and that child is now 6 years old. So we know we've been doing this for at least 6 years, but 6 or 7 years ago, there was a couple of incidences that happened in our community, and there were a couple of town hall meetings. We attended those town hall meetings, and what we heard from residents were, you know, we need parenting programs, we need after-school programs, we need, you know, health insurance for the kids. And we sat in the audience realizing that there was an after-school program a half a block away from where that town hall meeting was happening. We knew that there were parenting services that would go to the home of those families that were asking for them. We then went around and did listening tours at the school's PTOs.
Yep.
And we heard, for example, at one school PTO, we need parenting classes. And we literally walked 3 feet to the wall where a parenting class flyer was posted at that school. So what we realized was that part of what's happening in our community, there's a disconnect between what resources are out there and the knowledge that people have. Right. So we approached Larry Lee at 104.5 The Flame. Actually, it was 104.7 The Flame at the time. And we talked about doing some PSAs, community PSAs. He talked us into doing a weekly one-hour radio program on the AM station. And we held our own for a couple of years. Then he actually bumped us to the FM station.
Yeah.
And now we have this half-hour program that, again, is all about connecting you so that you can be the hero, the resource, the coordinator, the connector, so that when you're at your church or you're at the water cooler, if people still hang out at a water cooler, wherever you may be, and you talk to a family that says, you know, I'm looking for health insurance for my child, or I need an after-school program, you can say, hey, I listened to this cool show. You know, that's
cool.
That's a relative term.
Yeah.
and say, you know, I heard them talking about this resource, and connect those families so that we can in turn make St. Lucie County even better than what it is.
The other thing that I think we've heard from listeners over the years is that I always say that you issue challenges, but really we try to identify places in our programs or in partner agencies where you can get involved and make a difference. So, you know, at those town hall meetings so many years ago, everyone who was there was committed to making a difference. They wanted to do something to affect some change in the community, but they didn't know where to start. They didn't know what to do or what that looked like. So we have a ton of programs with opportunities that need volunteers or mentors or whatever support it is, time or talent that you have, that we try to find a place.
Or even treasure sometimes.
Or treasure, we'll take that too. But I think that's another thing that we always hear from our listeners is that it gives them an opportunity to learn about the things that they can do to give back. We know, for example, we had Guardian Ad Litem on, I think the end of last year, like December maybe. Within a week, they had received phone calls from people who signed up to be Guardian Ad Litems, which is amazing, and that's exactly what we want to happen. So. That's kind of
so. Thank you for listening and tuning in. Apparently, it's working.
And doing what we challenge you to do.
Because we always end the show, and I know we're not ending the show, but we always end the show with we're all in this together, and all in being the crucial part. So, like you said, either give your time, talent, or treasure to continue to make our community great.
Yes.
All right, so we have a wonderful guest who is also involved in that making our community great aspect.
You know, she does do a lot of that.
That's a pretty good segue, I think.
Do you want to introduce her? I know you know her a lot better than I do. I don't know if you have fun stories to tell about her.
Sure. So there is anybody familiar with the Lincoln Park area? There's this great initiative happening called the Common Good Initiative, and it's being spearheaded by the Allegheny Franciscan Ministries. Did I say that right?
You did.
Okay.
I had to look
at the paper to make sure I got it right. So we have with us, I don't know your exact title, but I just call you Allegheny Franciscan.
Regional
I know you're not the
president.
CEO, but.
It's regional
no, I'm
vice
not
president.
The CEO, and I'm not a sister, but I am the regional vice president for the Palm Beach region.
Upendo Shabazz from Allegheny.
Thank you, Sean. I appreciate you all having me here today.
Yeah, so we've actually been talking about this for a while, but you're a busy lady. You know, for somebody who's maybe not familiar with Allegheny or not familiar with Common Good, give us kind of a quick overview of what Allegheny does in the community and then how you guys have worked that into
Are we
our
sure
community.
That I can't give her a promotion to CEO? Is that on this show?
You can.
Okay, sorry.
Just in case my boss is watching. So Allegheny Franciscan Ministries, we are a grant-making health foundation, and it's the result of the sale of the hospitals in the regions in which the sisters had the hospitals. So in Tampa, in Palm Beach County, and in Miami-Dade. And so we sold the hospitals in 1998, and as a result of the sale, we've created this amazing grant-making foundation. We serve Palm Beach, Martin, and St. Lucie County in the Palm Beach region. We serve Miami-Dade in the Miami region, and in the Tampa is Hillsborough and Pinellas County. And so we make grants, just like Children's Services Council. We make grants to nonprofits focused on access to health care for marginalized communities, whether it's direct health services or information. So in 2014,
That was that long ago?
Really?
Yes, in 2014, our board of directors made a decision that they really wanted us to work more deeply in community. And so that's when the Common Good Initiative was created, which is really to work with community. And so Lincoln Park was identified out of 12 communities here in the Palm Beach region. And that's exciting.
It's very exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exciting because nine other communities did not get this opportunity.
And apparently I learned that I'm competitive. So I'm very excited that St. Lucie County won that competition.
Yes,
well,
yes.
You know what, though? I love that you bring that up because we have conversation all the time about, you know, we get lumped in with Palm Beach quite frequently. That our TV news is from there, is based out of there. And there are a lot of people who feel like they don't focus enough attention up here. Port St. Lucie is the fastest growing city in our state.
It's the seventh largest city in the state.
So I like that. I'm not quite as competitive as Sean, but
she's lying. She's just as competitive.
But I really appreciate the fact that, you know, out of the 10 communities that you guys were looking at, that Lincoln Park really stood out.
Yeah, Lincoln Park stood out for many reasons, but the four reasons I can tell you, number one, it was a community ready for change. Mm-hmm. Number two, it was a community in which we felt that we could make a difference on just whatever the community wanted to work with us on. Third, it was something that to our sisters, we felt that they had the same type of legacy of which the sisters would align to. And lastly was really the people love their community. And so for us, it was a no-brainer. Let's go with Lincoln Park. There were some initiatives already happening, so the community was already coming together with the Restoring the Village initiative, and we was like, okay, so we're gonna go to the community, and that's what we did. We went to the community in 2015. Remember, the board made the decision in 2014. We went to the community in 2014 after a year of me being on the ground, listening, talking with Sean, and other system leaders.
Why did she make that face when she said it that way?
Seriously, talking with Sean and other system leaders about what was going on in Lincoln Park. Had a little small group to kind of give me the feedback. And I took that feedback. We brought a facilitator in spring, May 2015, had this big community meeting. Over 200 residents showed up for me to give that feedback to them that I had heard. And then we came up with the three priorities for Lincoln Park, which is quality jobs and livable wages. The second one is safe and healthy neighborhoods. And the third is building community capacity. Now, the first priority was the one that actually had the most requests by the community, and that's not our experience. Our experience is funding nonprofits to do healthcare services. So for me, it was like a fish out of water. What do you mean? I thought you were going to work on health. We really wanted you to work on health. But again, listening to the community. And that's something that I think for the work that we're doing, we have to always do a feedback loop to the community, say, okay, are we doing what we said we're going to do?
Yep.
How's it working? How's it looking? So since 2015, we've invested about $1.7 million in the community. Each year, our board makes an allocation from our grant-making funds, and we carry whatever we don't use over. So since 2014, we've had $1 million each year for Lincoln Park. We have yet to spend what has been given to us because we don't just spend money. Y'all know something about that, right?
Yeah, we understand that very much so, yes.
We got you.
Yes, so we don't just spend it just because we have it. So we have a large pot of money, but we're slowly going through the process of investing the money based on the priorities that I talked to you all about.
Well, it's good, you know, from a strategy standpoint and just from a best practice, because we talk about this in our office, because we are also a grant funder or
really?
Grant-making organization.
I didn't know that,
yes.
Right?
And, you know, while we oftentimes look for best practices in programs, there's actually best practice in grant-making,
yes.
Which is that feedback loop that you talked about.
Yes.
If you're not constantly getting feedback from not only the people that you provide services to and the providers, but also the community at large, you're doing yourself a disservice.
Absolutely. And constantly, a consistent message that I give the community because, again, we knew it was going to take time for us to do any investment. So we created a pot of funds called the Impact Fund. And this is our way of still being on the ground with the community and responsive quickly versus really going through a process or really figuring out would the larger investment really work for this community. So that has gained us a lot more engagement in the community mm-hmm. because the Impact Fund is for any activity or sponsorship that happens in Lincoln Park. And I must say this, because I get this all the time, there are so many individuals, groups, nonprofits, and businesses that reach out to me and they're not in Lincoln Park. Mm-hmm. We want some of that Common Good Initiative money. That's not how it works.
So why don't you talk to our audience, how do you define Lincoln Park? Just so that if anybody's watching and they're like, I want some of that Allegany money, you can give them the boundary.
Okay, so the boundaries, and I have to tell you, it has opened up a little bit since we started. So the boundaries, the west is 33rd, which is Angle Road, that's the western border. The northern border is Avenue Q. The eastern border is US 1. And then the south border is Orange Avenue. So it's a big old box. Mm-hmm. It's about a 3.5 square mile radius, so to speak. And we actually extended it past 25th Street. It was originally cut off on 25th as the Western, but I got slapped on the hand. You know, we think we're in Lincoln Park too. So what has happened too, now I'm getting challenged now from the community as it relates to the northern border. They're saying, no, we're Lincoln Park further north. And I'm thinking like, really? Okay, we need to have this conversation.
If you hit Andrea Road, somebody's lying to you.
Yeah, you've gone too far.
Right.
But you know what? I love that you have the feedback loops, that you're like looking for that constant engagement. And I really like that you recognized that you get all these people together and you get them to agree that they want to see change and they want to make change. And it's really difficult, I think, as a grant maker, as a funder, we know that that change doesn't happen today or tomorrow or 5 years from now. It's going to take a long time, but to be able to, you know, kind of feed some impact in right away is really what they need to see to stay engaged. And so doing that, I think, is really smart to do it now so they can see it happening now and then keep them engaged for the long run.
Yeah, the Impact Fund, I think it was brilliant for us to create that opportunity. The max people can get is $5,000. And we have sponsored 5Ks, we sponsored t-shirts. Anybody that lives in Lincoln Park that has an idea or an activity that's going to bring the community out, that is what the Impact Fund is for. And so it's quick, it's easy, it's a quick turnaround. You can call me tomorrow, we can have a conversation, you tell me your budget, and I'll turn it right around back to you within a week. That's how quick it happens. And so that fund goes pretty quick, too.
we know how that goes.
Yeah, yes.
That fund goes really quick. But pretty much the investments that we've made to date that have been larger are more systemic. We fund the capacity building project, which is really focused on the nonprofits in Lincoln Park, really a year-long leadership program for them so they can learn governance, finance, board cultivation, just all the things that make an organization strong. So we work with 5 nonprofits that go through an application process. They work with a coach and they go through training all year long and receive a $20,000 stipend to implement their plan. They don't get it. They get $20,000. They have to create a plan with the coach as it relates to building their capacity, and then they work on investing in themselves.
And you're working with some of our programs.
How you know they weren't my programs first?
Because we're invested in them before you came on.
Maybe one or two, but not all of them.
No.
I said some of them.
Okay.
MRC, I'm sorry, Multicultural Resource Center, Save Our Children, Hazel's Group,
and the Image of Christ. Yes, but there were some that we had before that you all have now, thanks to us.
Who's the competitive one here? I get blamed for being competitive.
Oh, you're right. We're going to have to revisit her personality type. We'll have to reclassify that. So,
but that's exciting because I know, you know, just because an organization has an idea and you give them money, you can't automatically assume without some guidance and some capacity building that they can be as effective without it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the reason why I bring it up as it relates to the Common Good Initiative is that when we first came to the community, of course, we had a meeting with all the nonprofits and, you know, what do we got to do to get the money? And it was like, whoa, that's not how this works. But we recognized there was a need to really support those nonprofits in that community to build their capacity so they can be competitive, not only with us, but any other foundation or funder in the community, how to make them strong. And so for that, that's a way for us to support nonprofits. Our investments to date have been more systemic investments. which is challenging because it takes a lot longer to kind of build what investment that looks like. Mm-hmm.
My competitive side just remembered end it and sort outreach, but we'll leave it at that. But talk about, because I recently saw a presentation with you, Career Source, and the EDC, Economic Development
Council.
Because you kicked off a big kind of, I'll call it a jobs initiative or jobs training initiative.
It's called the Lincoln Park Career Pathways Initiative, and that is a partnership between the Economic Development Council, Career Source, Research Treasure Coast. Did I say that right? I should know that like the back of my hand. Indian River State College and the Treasure Coast Manufacturers Association.
Nice.
And just because I'm just a little bit competitive, we won the Best Practice Award from the Florida Career Pathways Summit this year.
Oh, nice.
And so what it basically is, it is really targeted to Lincoln Park residents to train them in three areas: certified logistics associate, certified production technician, and certified nursing assistant.
Wow.
They will go through a 6-week certification program, then they will take their test and they will become certified. With regards to the certified nursing assistants, they will go through their 6 weeks training, they will do their clinicals, and then 30 days after they have the ability to take the test, in which we pay for all of that. But the beauty about this, not saying that no other Pathways initiative has not looked like this, but the uniqueness with our initiative is that we have the Economic Development Council and the Treasure Coast Manufacturers Association that's going to be part of the continuum outside of certification. Now, once they finish certification, now we're gonna place them in jobs. And there's a commitment from all the manufacturers who have jobs available to interview all those individuals coming out. And that's unique. They made a commitment that they really, really wanna work with this community and hire from this community. So for me, that's huge.
That's
well, not for me, that's for the people of Lincoln Park.
Yeah.
That's huge. That's huge.
Well, okay, so we've talked about a lot of stuff, and I know we've got couple more minutes to talk about some more, but if somebody's interested, let's say we're talking and they're interested in the career pathways, or they have a nonprofit and they've got an event coming out in Lincoln Park, what's the best way to get all this information?
So the best way is to go to our website, www, that's three W's, right?
Who's counting, but yes.
Yeah, www.afmfl.org. Did you get that, Sean?
Got it. It's on the screen for our viewers.
AFMFL.org.
Yes.
Three W's.
And so they can go to the website and they will find information about the Common Good Initiative on one of the pages. They're going to have to search through. Sometimes people go to websites and if they don't see it right away, they just leave. But I want people to actually go through the website. And they'll find my contact information. They can reach out via the email or via the telephone, but I'm barely in the office, so the best way is email. I will call you back. It just may not be as soon as you want, but I do call people back. I just called people back yesterday that called me on the 8th, so I'm doing good.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good turnaround time.
That's good. So I have three counties to support.
It's a lot of phone calls.
Yeah.
I get it.
All right, so you had three components. You had the capacity building we talked about. Mm-hmm. You had the jobs and careers, which we talked about, and then your third component, which was safety.
Safe and healthy neighborhoods. So one of the investments that I'm so proud that we made, it's one of our big investments, our first big investment, it was a partnership with the City of Fort Pierce Police Department specifically. We knew that there were some challenges in Lincoln Park with regards to some of the gang violence and the shootings that was happening. And for us, again, listening to the community, one of the things that the community said back to us is that they wanted greater transparency with the police department. That was very clear in all the documents coming back from the community, greater transparency. And so after that shooting that happened in, I believe it was
15.
Yeah, 15.
I think so.
No, actually 16. In spring of 16, the shooting that happened, with everything that was going on in the community, as a grant maker, as a funder, particularly working the way that we're working in community, how can we assist this community? We hear that they wanted greater transparency, but also we have to remain very clear about what our role is. And so having conversations with the police department, having conversations with the city, again, greater transparency for the police department. They could not provide information back to the community as it related to that shooting. And it had to do with they didn't have the equipment that they needed. And so what we did is we partnered with the City of Fort Pierce. We challenged them to a $250,000 match grant to make it $500,000 to put equipment in Lincoln Park community with regards to greater safety and greater surveillance. So when things happen, they can provide that transparency back to the community. And that happened in 2016. To date, there has been a 22% decrease in violent crime in the community. And the police department says it has to do with the camera surveillance. So we're nice. Very proud of that.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, I was excited when I heard about it too. I said, what? and I think the last report that we got from the chief was about 32% this past year with regards to overall crime in the community. I think for us, particularly our board of directors, when I came before them with the recommendation, and I work for Sisters, the Sisters of Allegany, that's who I work for. People think I'm a sister some days, which is amazing. their biggest question is like, why should we invest in the police department? And then when they see what has happened and transpired since then, it makes sense because we are creating a safer neighborhood by investing in a system that from the community wasn't working for them.
Mm-hmm. Well, and yeah, I give the common good a lot of credit. I mean, not that you don't already know that, but you know, you come in as mainly a health funder and you listen to the community, and even you've already said it a couple times, like, we typically don't fund this, but this is what the community said that they want, and you're responding to the community. So I give you and the sisters a lot of credit for doing that. And I know you also have a local board that helps advise.
Yes, these are, we don't call them board, we call them council members. These are residents, people from the community, and people who have an investment in the community that sits around the table with me to help me make those decisions about our investment. I don't make those decisions by myself, just like I know you all don't make those decisions by yourself. A lot of people think I make decisions, but in actuality, no, I don't. I give the information to the people that's around the table. We sit, we debate, we go through the whole process of making an informed decision about what type of investment we need to make as it relates to one of those three priorities. And mm-hmm. so we have 11 members right now. Sean, did you want to be a member? No, I'm just kidding.
I think, you know, as Sean said, it really speaks to, you know, you're getting the feedback from the community, you're implementing the things that they want to see, and that's really how you keep people motivated and kind of on your page. So I think what has happened here is awesome, and we look forward to seeing what continues to happen.
Yeah, I'm excited too. I mean, the one thing that, again, our experience is healthcare, but when you think about those three priorities, they are social influences of health.
Right.
You know, economics and safety, and it's important for people who need access to healthcare that they have those components as well. So,
yeah, definitely.
So we encourage all of our listeners and viewers to go to their website at www.afmfl.org.
Good
did
job.
I say it right?
You did.
All right. And we are about out of time. I will say real quick, the work that you've done in regards to health in our community, you helped fund the fetal infant mortality review,
yes.
And we are picking that baton up and funding the recommendations that came out
and
of it.
And you all should.
Yeah. All right, folks, we are out of time. Remember, it's our children, our community, our future. We're all in this together. We'll see you next time.